part 1. The topic which we shall be learning today, it is called control. The control and its related techniques. Control is something which is a super important element for any organization, and it also these controls can be called as internal controls. So if I ask you, who has a primary responsibility to have controls in the company and make sure the control works? It is absolutely on the management. Senior management is the person who is responsible to have controls in the organization, and also the task is not just to make control but also make sure that the controls work effectively and efficiently. So the purpose of this particular chapter to understand various kind of controls which are in place, and also once we understand those controls, then only as an auditor we will understand whether the company have those controls in place or not. The part of internal auditor's job is to definitely comment on the internal control of a business. Whether the internal control exists or not, whether it works efficiently and effectively or not. For that, first we need to understand what type of controls an organization should have, and then only we'll be able to analyze whether it is there or not. So as an auditor, there are three type of skills which are required in us to assess those controls. So the first part of this session, we shall be discussing those kind of skills which are there for auditor, and post that we will talk about various kind of controls in an organization. So let's start with those skills first, understand what kind of skills are mandatory or very very important for auditors to have it. So let's talk about that now. The three type of elements, the first is called the analysis, the second is called synthesis, and the third is called evaluation. If we talk about skill set of an auditor, the experience, the knowledge, primarily these are three important elements in which all three parts will cover everything about audits. Let's talk about this part first, analysis. What is analysis? Analysis is looking at the total circumstances and seeing what all elements do we have. Once we know those elements, we need to see the relationship among those elements. As an auditor, whenever we go inside an organization, the first thing what we have to do is we have to analyze. We have to analyze the company and its related controls. What are the important elements of those controls, and what are the relationship among those elements? What if one element will get impacted? Will that impact the other elements or not? So this is how we basically analyze something. When we analyze, we used a technique which is called deductive reasoning. Let's understand what does that mean. Deductive reasoning means we start with generic, we go to specific. From a generic observation to moving to specific is called deductive reasoning. So when we analyze, we always follow deductive reasoning. Let me give you an example. I really want to know whether the company is efficient in production department or not. Are they able to manage their capacity of machine or not? Now that is something I want to know as a control. So I'll be starting from a generic procedure, which is the company taking any deviation while giving the discounts to the customer? How much is that? How much that element is impacting the company's profitability and contribution margin? From there, I'm moving slowly to production. So have you seen that we have started from a generic portion, moving towards a specific portion called production? That is deductive reasoning. So as an auditor, when you analyze the situation, you analyze an organization and it is controlled, use a deductive reasoning. Now, the next element is called synthesis. The synthesis means you have to start from specific and go to generic. So it is kind of opposite what you understood in analysis. Here we use something called the inductive reasoning. I will be starting from a specific element going to the generic element. For example, when I have to talk about my scope of work, engagement work profile. So suppose we have got a client and we have to design a scope of work for them, engagement work. For that, I need lot of other elements information. For example, the hierarchies in the company, their past performances, what was the report of past auditor, and so on. So in this case, I am using inductive reasoning. In analysis, we started with generic going to specific. In our synthesis, we start from specific, go to generic. This is called inductive reasoning. Once we have understood both elements like analysis and synthesis, it's time for us to talk about evaluation. Evaluation combined these two techniques together. So we need to have deductive reasoning, we need to have inductive reasoning, we need to see the totality of the circumstances and the element, and then we have to observe and then conclude on the control part. So ultimately, when we talk about evaluation is a combination of synthesis skill and the analysis skill. When we talk about auditor's judgment, about sampling, about making up questionnaires and drawing any conclusion out of it, we basically deal with this element called evaluation. We evaluate all the elements. We see the totality, we see the specific portion. Accordingly, we design what kind of procedures, tool and technique we have to follow for audit. Also, we decide what type of questionnaire should be formed to ask from employee. What should be the relevant controls in place? And this is how we as an auditor start our work. So I hope by now we have understood all three elements: analysis, synthesis, and evaluation. In examination, they may ask certain multiple choice question, which can be a slightly case-based question, where they could ask as to whether it is an inductive reasoning or a deductive reasoning. So this is how we have to understand thoroughly those concepts. So I'm sure by now we have understood these three elements. Now it's time for us to talk about the relevant controls in place. A company need to have multiple control, be it financial, be it operational, be it process specific, and so on. So let's try to understand those controls one by one now. Let me just bifurcate the controls in two major portions. Any control in the company can be in two forms: primary and secondary. This is first type of control. The primary controls are those control which are first line of control in the company. So these are the control which are very, very important element, and these are must for a company. The secondary controls are those controls which supports or they compensate the primary control. So secondary control is secondary. These are basically helping the other control technique. Primary control is the first line of defense in a company. Now primary control can further be reclassified into various parts. Let's classify the primary control as preventive control, detective control, the preventive controls, the detective controls, the corrective controls, and then directive controls. These are four important controls which are there in the primary control: preventive, detective, corrective, and directive. let's talk about preventive part first. As the name suggests, before any unwanted event occur, these controls stop them. They create a deterrent in the process so that something will not go haywire. We call them preventive control. For example, segregation of duty. When there are segregation of duty, we make sure the company's controls are in place. A person is not having end-to-end access of anything. If a person has end-to-end access of a process, goes without saying there is higher risk of fraud available. So preventive controls stop any unwanted event. So they create a deterrent in the process. The detective controls are those controls who raise an alarm. When unwanted event has occurred, the detective controls are those controls which raise an alarm so that people will get to know something is going wrong. For example, most of the companies these days are having automatically hard blocks in SEP. If you try to bypass the company's process, say for payment of invoice, the system will not let it pass. If somebody is trying to do it, probably it may raise an alarm. The another situation could be that I have a fire alarm. The moment there will be any sign of fire, the alarm will ring. It's a detective control. Corrective control. The unwanted event has already occurred. Now it's time for us to correct it. So what will be the corrective control? The straining. So here we are trying to correct the things which has already occurred, unwanted event. So probably now I'm having maker and checker in the company so that anything which has occurred can be corrected now. Every time it will go to the next level of authority, it will be checked. Directive control. I want a particular event, that's my desirable event. So any control which are directed towards a desirable event is called directive control. For example, the trainings of staff, the time to time policies which needs to be told to the staff as to how it needs to be done. Time to time management keeps checking their control so that they make sure that the directive or favorable events have been achieved. So these are the four type of control which comes under primary control. We can call them preventive, detective, corrective and directive. Preventive control prevent the unwanted event. The directive detect, the detective detect those kind of things. Corrective controls are those who corrects the unwanted things. And finally, directive is something where we try to achieve the desired result. So these are the primary controls. Let's talk about secondary control now. So here we are trying to classify secondary into two parts. The compensatory and complementary. As the name suggests, compensatory controls are those controls which come into place when primary control fails. For example, I have a very small shop where there is an owner and there is one employee who is basically responsible for all kind of activities, being a very small shop. So this employee only makes an entry, he is the one who counts the cash also. What could be the compensatory control here? The next morning the owner or the supervisor come earlier than employee and cross-check the count of cash. This is compensatory control. Here my preventive control was missing. I do not have a segregation of duty. Now to compensate those kind of control, we are talking about compensatory. Complementary controls are those controls which supports the primary control. They are not a substitute of it, but they rather support it. For example, that every time there is a bank reconciliation made, there is a third person, somebody outsider, who comes and check the bank reconciliation. So it's just complementing your deep primary control to make sure that controls are in place and they are working effectively and efficiently. So that was the first classification of control. We can call them primary control, secondary control. Primary has its own sub-classification, so is the secondary. So I hope by now we have understood the first classification of control called primary and secondary. Now once we have understood this classification, let's talk about more classification of control. Now let's talk about the processing related or system related controls now. So as we have just discussed the major category of control called primary and secondary, let's talk about more on the application controls now. So the application controls can be further reclassified as input, processing and output. What is an application in the company? We have input, we process it and then finally we get an output. So every process, be it input, be it primary or be it output, that has to be completely controlled. If we talk about input control, there could be batch related control, there could be control on what it's being input inside the company. We need to understand that garbage in and garbage out. So if your input is wrong, everything is wrong. So there has to be proper control as to how the input is happening. For example, the moment a company's staff is punching an entry, there has to be proper source document available. That source document will have worked as an input control. There could be batch control. So if the total amount of batch needs to be say $100,000, if every line item has any error, the batch total would not match. So in this case, it is input control. The second type of control is processing. So how the processings are done? Is it as per the SOP of the business or not? As per as the defined policies and procedure or not? So that is processing control. And finally comes output control. Whatever is being generated, how it is being distributed, is this output available to those people who are not the right user or not? So those kind of control comes under output. So in nutshell, we can call them application control. Application are having three part: input, processing and output. Now similarly, we can have more classification called time-based. The time-based controls are those controls which are basically defined by the timeline as to when these kind of controls should come into picture. The first is feedback. The next is concurrent or continuous. And the third one is called feed-forward. Let's talk about it one at a time. Feedback, as the name suggests, is a backward-looking approach. Feedback is always given after the task. For example, you have already given the exam and now we are discussing that you should have ticked down A or B and so on. Can we go back and change our result? No, we may not. We can only improve in our next exam. It's a backward-looking approach. So a control which is based on what has occurred is called feedback control. In feedback control, we can look it in the past, we see what has gone wrong, correct it in future. Anything which was good needs to be recreated. So this is what we call feedback control. It's a definitely time based because it is whether it is related to present or future or past. In this case, it's a past-related control. Continuous control, as the name suggests, is a control which is ongoing. In this case, we do not talk about past. We say, okay, fine, this process is not going right, correct it right now. So it's a concurrent process, it's a continuous process where we keep changing the things, keep amending the things. Now that is what we call continuous control. Most of your internal audits are concurrent in nature, continuous in nature, which works as a continuous control inside the company. Then comes feed forward. As the name suggests, forward looking approach. We look it in the future, we foresee the problems in future and we correct it. For example, let's talk from a management's point of view. Suppose a company made a budget for cash. They thought their cash situation will be good in this year. Foreseeing those cash situation, they basically planned a capital purchasing in this year. They thought they will be buying a machinery for this year. Within 2-3 months, the company realized, the management realized, that company is not able to recover the money from debtors. Now, as if they go with the original budget, what will happen? The company will have a cash crunch situation. Anyways, cash is less. At this point of time, if company buys a machinery, what will happen? The company will have a very serious cash crunch problem. So if they see that risk in future, they can take a corrective measure today itself, like they can postpone the purchase, they can go for a working capital loan, they can speak to the vendor for EMI kind of thing. But those corrective action can only be taken when you foresee that problem in future. If management is not having capability to see that problem, how will they resolve it? So this is what we call feed forward control, which is future looking. So if you have to classify as per time based, feedback, backward looking, feed forward, future looking, continuous, in present way, we keep controlling things. So this is what we call the time based classification of control. There can be various other controls. Let's talk about other controls now. Let's talk about another control called financing versus operating control now. The controls can be on numbers. Financing controls may include your profit margins, your capital, your cash, anything which is related to financing. So those controls which are primarily focused on the finances of the business is called financing control. The operating controls are primarily focused on the operations of the business. A company needs to think about their production, the efficiency of the production, what is the machine utilization. All this comes under production related control. So that can be one more classification, financing and operating. The one more classification could be people based and system based. The people based controls are those controls where people are responsible for control. For example, having a guard outside the cash vault. A people based control, you are relying on people for the control. The system based control, where system is responsible for the control. So whenever a particular entry will exceed the amount which is authorized, system will put a block on it. Those kind of control are called system based control, where system does not let pass anything which override the policy. This is what we call system based control. So this can be one more classification. So by now we have understood the concept as to what kind of skill set are required for auditor. Then we talked about various kind of control. Now let's talk about another concept called control matrix. Let's see how control matrix works and how it can be important for a company. Let's make a control matrix. I'm writing risk 1, risk 2, risk 3, risk 4. A company can have multiple type of risk. Let's write control A, control B, control C. A company can have multiple control for multiple risks. So it looks like a matrix. But it is not necessary that every time you have to match only one control with one risk. No, it's not necessary at all. It can be in the form of matrix. Control A can be for risk 1, can be for risk 3 also. The control B can be for risk 2, can be for risk A also, and so on. So basically, in this case, the one control can be designed for multiple risks. It's not always necessary that one risk is equal to one control. Not always. That is why we make something called control matrix. In control matrix, the risks and the controls are matched, aligned, not always or necessarily one-on-one basis. This is the concept of control matrix. So by now we have understood a lot of things about control. Let's make a dummy flow chart and the process of a company and see how the procurement process works. I'm not saying that every company uses exactly the same procedure, but these days most of the multinational company will have almost similar procedure. If you look at your book, the book has given you multiple flow charts, whether it's for cash processing, cash receipt, cash payment, sales, purchase. Those flow charts are very, very important for examination. You just don't need to remember everything just like that. When you look at those flow chart, you need to understand the flow and the related controls. Now, these controls can be important for us to understand the kind of question generally comes in examination. They may give you process and they'll ask you which control is missing here or which control is something where you can advise the management to strengthen further. For that, first we need to understand the controls. So I'm just talking about one process here, which is procurement process or purchase process for a company. Similarly, you can see all the flow charts given in the book and understand the flow of that transaction. And with this, you'll understand the related controls also. So let's talk about a procurement process in the company. Company can use multiple methods for procurement. It could be a sealed envelope kind of purchasing. It could be a negotiated kind of procurement process also. So let me just take you through a process where a company is going for a negotiated procurement. It is almost mandatory for company to have minimum 3 bids from the vendors. If company wants to purchase anything, minimum 3 vendors should be invited. The quotation should be taken and then company should go ahead with the. It is mandatory for the company to go for a sole sourcing because they do not have any other option. But in a normal scenario, company should not opt for it. So let's talk about a situation where a company needs marker. This is something which we need to purchase. So let's see what should be the process. The first document which will come into picture is called PR. PR stands for Purchase Requisition. Who creates it? The department which needs that good is creating a document called PR, Purchase Requisition. Purchase requisition generally do not have the value. It only talks about the specs of the item, when do they want it, how many is required. So if you have to basically procure the marker, how many markers are required, when do they need it. And this document should be supported by the relevant business approval. So if finance department needs marker, they need to get a permission from their own respective finance manager and the PR should be supported by that approval. So that is the first document which comes into picture. But please remember that PR is not a legal document. It is absolutely internal document. Okay? So basically, as we are talking about purchase process, the first document comes into picture is PR. This PR goes to procurement department. The procurement department contact minimum 3 vendors in this field. They take a quotations from them, they see their specifications, and they compare the quality and the price. Of course, the vendor with the minimum pricing and the good quality will be preferred. So procurement gets into negotiation with the vendor and finally they approve one particular vendor for purchasing the particular stuff. Then comes a legal document into picture called PO. PO stands for Purchase Order. This is the legal document. Anything and everything what a company wants to make it legally enforceable should be included in PO. Anything which is not in PO is not legally enforceable. So it has the quantity, amount, taxation, date of delivery, place of delivery, addresses of both parties, any terms and condition, the interest and penalty clause, and so on. Whichever company wants to put in an agreement, that is there in the PO. So purchase order is a legal document which comes under definition of contract act. Once PO comes into picture, the vendor started making the goods and services and then they delivered to the purchase company. So for example, as in this case company wanted to procure the marker, the manufacturer of marker who was given the PO will be making the marker, will deliver it to the company on the designated date. At this point of time, a document comes into picture called GRN, which stands for Goods Received Note. This GRN can be manually taken in the system, it can be automatic also. A SAP in different company may have a different procedures. So once the goods are delivered, for example, you are working in accounts department, accounts payable department, and your warehouse has received say 100 markers. The moment you got a confirmation from the warehouse, you will tick GRN that okay, fine, goods have been received. Once GRN is done, the vendor creates document called invoice. The invoice date starts from the date when the purchaser receives it. So suppose company says that our payment period is 30 days. So 30 days will start from where? The day when the company, the purchaser will receive an invoice. So the invoice will come into picture and finally the payment will be done to the vendor. Now, this is a normal procedure how procurement occurs. Let's talk about relevant controls now at each and every stage of this process. The first thing what as an auditor you should know is that the PR should be supported by proper authority who's authorized to approve that particular product and the relevant amount. Then you have to check whether it was a sole sourcing or the proper procurement process was followed or not. It may be possible that due to kickbacks and bribery angle, the procurement manager and vendor may have some kind of settings. So that needs to be checked. Now comes system related controls. Remember we talked about people based and system based. So let's talk about system based. Every SAP has something called three-way match now. Three-way match means the PO, the GRN, and the invoice. Unless and until these three items will match, system will not let the payment occur. Hard block for sure. That's why it's called three-way match. The PO, the invoice, and GRN. All three should be matched. If there is any mismatch in these documents, system will not let this process happen. Payment would not happen. So this is a system related. These days companies are going to better than three-way match and there is called four-way match. So companies who follow best practices are not just following three-way match but four-way match. The four-way match will include one more document called physical inspection. Invoice is there, the GRN is there, the PO is there. But how would you make sure that those 100 markers were good when it came to warehouse? They were not faulty. How do you know whether 100 markers were received at warehouse or only 80 were received? Probably the supervisor at warehouse was not even aware about this. So isn't that better if you go for a physical inspection too? And that's what we call four-way match. So that's a system-based match. Here, the segregation of duty needs to be there. This needs to be separate department. This is absolutely separate department. The department which takes care of this part is separate and the party which makes payment is a separate department. That is another control called segregation of duty. So this is how, with one process, I'm sure we have understood how should be a normal process, what are the related controls, and what could be the loopholes. For example, if the system does not have a three-way match option, a loophole, a party who's finalizing the vendor is the one who's doing the payments also. No controls. So this is how we need to understand those flowcharts and the relevant controls. So I'm sure by now we have understood how to read that element in the book. So with this, we are done with a small chapter called Control and Techniques. We understood the skill set which is required in auditor, which includes analysis, synthesis and evaluation. We talked about various kind of controls, be it primary or secondary, be it finance or operation, be it time-based control and so on. And finally, we talked about a process of purchasing and the related control. This chapter can be very important for examination. My suggestion is that when you read that chapter, please read it thoroughly. So that's all about this particular chapter. Let's meet up once again with a new topic. Till then, stay tuned. Thank you.